Making a life worth living and retirement worth having is really about the people in our lives. It's about the number of times we talk to people, it's about the number of times that they tell us they'll do something, and it's also about the number of times that they may not follow through on what they say they're going to produce for us. Isn't that interesting that we can produce for them, but they don't always perform for us? And that's sort of what happens in life, that we can tell someone, listen, I need to talk to you, and they can completely ignore us, or technological companies can totally prevent us from being able to talk to someone. We have all sorts of people online who literally will shut off their direct messaging capabilities on their own accounts. And you sit there and wonder, why are you online? Is it just to allow people to voyeur on your life, or is it so that you can produce a result? You see, the results we produce in our life is what produces for us a life, but that's not always truthful. You see, we do have technology companies that are promising us free services, but the problem is we don't regularly know how much of that free service we are truly receiving. The challenge is if we're using these free technology tools and social media conglomerates to utilize for job hunting and employment searches or business development, and we're not paying for the tool because we haven't seen a value, and when we tried to pay for it or sample it, then there's a problem. It means that we might be putting our information out into Never Never Land, which means we never, never, never get connected to the people we're trying to get connected to. I've literally sent an email, a text message, and almost a voicemail to someone that I'm saying, look, I need to give you this documentation. It's more than time. I've been talking about it to you for almost a year, and why is it that you're not responding to me? Openly, I can't figure that out because supposedly all these tools work, and yet when I call the company to confirm that that individual is present so I could send a courier or someone I know to carry that documentation to that individual, I'm told that person no longer works there. I don't find that in affirmations when I look on the social media for that individual. It looks like they're still employed there. But if they left the country, if they moved on, if they've done some world tour and I don't know about it, that's not really on me. It's on them for failing to produce a better technology in the world. Now, we have a lot of politicians out there talking about a lot of things. And I question what they're talking about because in my life, the things they're talking about don't really matter. I mean, they matter on the global scale, of course. They matter in the fact that I'm a member of a world citizen. I'm a part of the international treaties that are literally out there in the land in the United Nations. I mean, as an American citizen, I am expected to comply in the states in which I live with those international treaties. What I find absolutely fascinating is that the politicians and government don't completely understand that those international treaties actually govern not only federal law, but also the state laws that they're trying to change on people in their rights. You see, international human rights declarations are really a form of a treaty between world powers. And if we're going to say that we're a part of a world power, then we must honor those liabilities and those legalities and those litigations and any other L word you want to use that has been assessed by our president, by other important, brilliant minds that are employed by the political climate, and literally who determined what is and isn't human rights. There's a big issue going on right now for female reproductive rights, and I have to tell you that in God's house, the house of the Lord, which is that who I represent these days and a lot of things I talk about, because I really see a bastardization of the biblical word. And the truth is that the Lord did not give any man in any position of political power the right to tell a woman what she can and cannot do with her body. That is something that my particular guides are pretty emphatic about, and they're really pissed off at the people in Georgia who think that they don't have to honor the international treaties of the United Nations, which literally says that a person has a right to their own physical being, and no one has the right to manipulate, mutilate, or monsterize their rights in that regard. It's important that we get back to that International Human Rights Declaration for anyone who's a politician today. Anyone who's trying to become president needs to get on the bandwagon and the platform of peacemaking in the land and peacemaking in the world. We also have a great threat going on within our nation that people are not paying attention to. We have young people and old people who think that theft is an okay thing. We have young people in our current community who literally will take a pair of glasses off someone's hat or off their head, and we don't notice because we're not expecting it. We're not living in the hood, if you will, in the affluent communities in which we reside. We're living where we expect certain amounts of dignities, certain amounts of propriety, and certain amounts of personal boundary spacing going on. I get a little tired of the young children that are being brought into the local fast food restaurants who come from areas that are less well off. Now, what I mean by that is I'm not trying to be arrogant because I'm an impoverished person. I am unemployed, I'm underemployed, and I'm certainly homeless. But I've had a few blessings from some good people is absolute truth. But when I go and invest my last dollars, if you will, in a place for food, I expect my food is not going to be tainted by some Hispanic worker trying to monkey with me, cause me to fall asleep so they can get into my baggage, and I most certainly expect that my rights are going to be honored underneath international human rights treaties that says you have no lawful right to touch me to get into my clothes or get into my baggage whatsoever. You have no right to monopolize my time. You have no right to track my movement. You have no right to put a dog tag underneath my skin and my foot or in any part of my being with a shot that I didn't ask for. And openly, we have a problem with that in the land. That people are monitoring other people through social media is true. We do. We pay attention to the people that we like, the people that we trust, or the people that we know, or the people that we have curiosities about. I recently read an article in Wikipedia about two women that I never really knew much about and was trying to figure out, are they involved in this hotel chain, or are they just out there because they've got the money from grandpa or daddy to do what they do? You see, when you go stay at a place, it's representing not only that hotel chain, but it's also representing that family name, that family individual. And if they're an idiot in social media, then maybe that's why their staff in those places are ridiculous. But I could just throw that out there as an opinion, because as a reporter, I'm allowed to render a column and an opinion. Now, when I talk about my own personal experiences with local people, I have the right to share that story. I also have the right to tell you what the experience is like from the consumer point of view of visiting lots of little churches around the land and how they treat foreigners and how they treat guests and how they treat guys who are furry and look a bit like a Muppet like me today. But I'm doing this because one person said something to the Lord, and the Lord has said, this is what she said, so here I am, furry face and all. But the reality is, that's my right to know, because God provides it to me. Now, when I talk about this, you're like, what is he talking about? Because we have this problem. We have a lack of listening in America, a total, utter lack of listening. The late Steve Shapiro is a wonderful man who did his fabulous CD for us in a group called Team in Focus in 2003, while he was still with us. He talked about the gift of listening and how important it is to listen fully without trying to formulate some sort of response in your mind of what you're going to say. He also talks about how you listen and learn, and that by listening you learn what's going on for someone, and by listening you learn and see the avenues of opportunity to help someone. I literally offered my services in exchange for something to a particular group. And within an hour or two of the man originally being interested and open, he obviously gossiped to someone, maybe his father, maybe his mother, maybe his wife or his future girlfriend, I don't really know. But the reality is, someone in his organization let him know that he didn't have to do that. Now, I had a lovely lunch with people who were welcoming and folding me into their congregation, which was great. But at the same time, when I got back to a place to lodge and I opened my bag, I found that my underwear had been peed on by someone. Now, as a man of my age, I know precisely what my own urine smells like and when I need to change my own underwear. Now, I'm being silly here, but I'm being comical too, because we all age, we all defy our genetics in some way, and at some point, dripsville does occur. We all know this. If you haven't listened to your own mother, then you haven't heard that either. But in truth, we're talking about real life here on this audiocast programming, and I'm talking predominantly right now about the mayhem of the world, the mayhem of the globe. We've got a lot of monsters in the world, is true. We've got a lot of people raising monsters, is absolute truth. I just watched a little temper tantrum of a little girl in an elevator because she wasn't allowed to be the first one to touch the elevator buttons. That was a parent's fault. The parents didn't prepare the child for entering the elevator. I literally had to say, excuse me, could I come out of the elevator? To get the parents to say, move out of the way, children. You see, we've got a problem with parenting, and only a president like Marianne Williamson could help people to understand how to better parent the souls of their children so that we produce peaceful, loving people in the land. Now, she shouldn't have to struggle to find her support because she has written some amazing work in the spiritual realm and in other aspects of living life fully and recognizing the soul of an individual. Now, she would make a grand president, probably. We also have a fabulous up-and-comer in Kamala Harris, who is a lawyer. And let's face it, litigation is the name of the game in politics. You've got to know what the laws are, you got to know how to read the law, you got to know what to do with the law, you got to know how to apply the law, and you got to expect the fact that someone who's a lawyer is going to know how to fight for the rights of American people, not just educators across the land. Because, yeah, it's true, educators are underemployed a lot of times, or they're overemployed. Now, what I mean by that? Well, having been an educator in public school, I can tell you that the fees were not awesome, but I was there to help out because I had a business in the community, and I had part-time that I could contribute to the fact that their teacher literally went on pregnancy leave, and they didn't have someone who could do what I could do. So I went in, and I did that in public school. Now, as a man, that was unique because I wasn't exactly prepared at that moment in time to be a superstar educator, but they brought me in on a special teaching license. I did that. I got it. It took a lot of hours to prepare for class is somewhat true. I utilized the computers to do those things is true. But openly, when I'm sitting here in a public library and my computer wants to shut down on me, that's a violation of my rights. I'm in the middle of recording something. Who gives the computer, or anyone who's monitoring me, the right to do anything to the fact that I'm publicly doing this, and these are the federal rights that we have? The right to access information, the right to freedom of speech, the right to assembly, the right to go places and do things without somebody monkeying around in our property. You see, when you're homeless, it's your bags and your person and your pockets that is really your home. We don't allow people to put their hands on other people, yet for some reason, if someone falls asleep, people think it's okay to do. That is an illness in the mind of youth today, that it's a joke, it's a comedy, because they are spoiled rotten, they haven't had to work 1 cent in their life, is what I'm thinking, and if they did, it was simple chores. But it didn't have to produce for them a life, it didn't have to produce for them a shelter, it didn't have to produce for them food on the table, and they're getting that from their parents. Now, if parents are not properly teaching their children how to produce a life, that's one thing. If we have monsters in land interfering with people's rights, like technology companies, to get connected to the people they need to get connected to in order to make a living, that is something that a politician should be taking up with those companies, especially if you're the official representative of the state in which those companies have their home offices and their headquarters. So what I'm saying is that we need a president who's going to fight for the daily rights of people. The daily rights that make the most sense are we all have to be employed. Therefore, employment should matter to every profession out there, not just teachers, not just people in a particular subset of a culture. We have to get onto the issues that matter today. I get tired of these wonderful esoteric passages that these people write or that their script writers or their political consultants write for them, but they say virtually nothing about how they're going to impact the daily life of people. Now, I could be easily poo-pooed upon because I'm making my opinion rendered. I'm putting it out there and I'm saying, look, you want to impact my life? Help me find a job. You want to help impact my life? Tell these librarians and tell these people in these work centers that are representations of the state and tell these other people who are in some sort of position of power or authority that they have no right to voyeur on my life. It's my right to get a job. Now, I'm passionate, so I'm going to be assertive. I'm going to be matter of fact in my conversation. I'm not going to produce the most joyous audio cast every single minute because I'm literally being perpetrated against. Every time I set a bag down, someone is taking something out. I've lost a fork, I've lost a knife, I've lost things out of my bag that should still be right in the pouch that I left them in. We create these bags that have open pockets to put our beverages in and other things we need handy. A simple pen that I put in my pocket is no longer there. You see, we have monsters that will infiltrate our sleep time, that will open a hotel door, that will walk in while we're asleep and take things. Who gives them the right to do this is only the legal aspects of the law, not at all, but the liars of the land. Liars of the Land is an upcoming film that I'm working on producing along with my other films, The Dragon Priest and House of the Lord. But in truth, what I'm really talking about here is that when we're looking for a politician in a political climate, we need somebody who knows how to produce peace and knows how to fight for rights. But fighting for rights of all people, not a subset, not an ethnic group, not that, every single American who is lawfully, legally here. I feel bad for the people who are stuck at the border, but here's what I feel. Having produced a person and her child into the United States on legal grounds, I find it offensive that these people are coming to America illegally and expecting us to admit them legally. I don't want to say that I don't care about the strifes in their country. What I want to say is that we have many humanitarians who are happy to take their millions of dollars like the Virgin Airlines dude and go down there and teach them a new way of life. He literally could probably buy the whole country if he wanted to and fix it. That's what I'm saying. Now, for putting money into gorillas in the mist, that's sort of a waste of time because animals are not going to produce life for people. All they're going to produce is a risk to a physical being who's walking close enough to them and near a wild animal, like you've got control. And if you don't have a shotgun, you got no repercussions for the fact that there's a group of them and you hit one, you still got to hit them all. So I might be being facetious about something I've recently observed, but look, in life, human beings make the world go round. Everything we do in life is about protecting our lives from the wild, protecting ourselves from the predators of the wild, and protecting ourselves from people who have never learned the rules of societies. You see, we have the three R's in the world, the roles, the rules, and the responsibilities. Okay? The rules, the roles, and the responsibilities. I'm going to say that in backwards, and you can flip it around as many times as you want to. But the reality is that there are rules of this land. And thou shalt not steal is a fundamental rule, and every single act of aggression, every single act of dismay, every single act of murder is based on someone didn't understand the rules. that theft of anything, any piece of property, any personhood, is immoral, illegal, and illicit. And that's where we begin in fixing some of our problems. That we must train people in why America came into being, why our forefathers wrote what they wrote, and why it's an honor and a privilege to be an American citizen. Those flocking here sort of know it, but they come here illegally, and they do illegal and immoral things. They violate people's rights, they violate their homes, they violate their bags. They just think America is ripe for the picking. It's not. America is a land that I love. It's a place that I was born and raised, and it's a place that my father honored his military service in to the point of lieutenant colonel. Even into his late years, he wore that hat proudly. He had that on his car as a license plate on the front, because in Indiana we don't have required two front and back. And openly, he proudly displayed his American flag on every single honorable holiday. But he was also a compassionate man. He would have never called police on anyone unless there was a lawful right to do it, and I called police on him once or twice because of his outrageous behavior. But the reality is that's not the point. The point is that we have to have peacekeepers in the land. Not, I'm going to piss on thee people. And that's what I'm talking about. That we have people who will invite you over for supper. You'll put your bag down, and while you're eating supper with their family, they will have a family member go into your baggage. This is an illness. It's an immorality, and it is ridiculous. Now, I've just received a great blessing in a hotel stay last evening from a lovely little church that has a very few number of people, but a very kind and compassionate and thoughtful pastor. It wasn't precisely what I was after, but it was a great gift to be able to take a bath and to be able to have a good night's rest without being monkeyed with, because I realized how I could protect myself in that place. Now, in life, we have to start preaching and teaching about souls. We have to talk about laws, and we have to have a president who understands the difference between what is morally right in their mind versus what is righteously right in the Lord God's house above all. Thanks for listening. Blake Ensign, Blaze Communications, LLC, talking about real-world things, politics, public opinion, and journalistic columning, I guess, is the best way to explain what I'm doing. Thanks for listening.